Good morning, everyone. Welcome, Christ United Methodist Church. Today is May 30th. Oh, we're glad you're here. We have just a few announcements this morning. On June 8th, the State of Ohio Health Department Mobile Unit will be here at Christ United Methodist Church from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. with a vaccine, another COVID vaccine clinic. We are in need of a few people to help out. If you'd like to volunteer, please contact church office, let them know. And feel free to spread the word among anybody you might know that still needs the COVID-19 vaccine. Starting June 6th, we will start having worship service in our parking lot. Parking lot church, we've been doing the first Sunday of the month, but the month of June, we are going to do, weather permitting, every week during the month of June, we will have parking lot church at 10:15 Sunday morning. And then, if conditions continue to improve, tentatively, we are planning to move indoors in July. That would be July 4th, our first Sunday back inside. We hope, fingers crossed, prayers lifted, if conditions continue to improve. Let's hope. This is not carved in stone. I want to make sure everybody knows that. We are hoping that things are good enough by July to move indoors. Let's see. June 1st, just a couple of days, the United Methodist Women unit meeting will be on Zoom. That's open to anybody that wants to attend, but it's on Zoom, so you will need an invitation with the link to get on that Zoom meeting. If you have not been invited and you would like to be invited, please contact Nancy Prater. If you don't have her contact information, contact church office, and they'll make sure that you make all those connections. All right, those are all of our announcements this morning. Would you join me in our call to worship? This comes from Psalm chapter 29. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forests bare, and in His temple all cry, glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as King forever. The Lord gives strength to His people. The Lord blesses His people with peace. Let's sing together, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
Let us pray. Oh God, we have come to hear your voice. Help us, we pray, to quiet our hearts and minds that we might be still and listen. Help us to open our hearts so that we might be willing to change for the better. May you be at work in us so that we can be more like you each day and become more like the people you created us to be. Amen. Not long ago, there was a time when a well-known taunt asked, "Who's your daddy?" That phrase was popular enough to appear on playgrounds and high school hallways and pick up basketball games, sitcoms, and Hollywood movies. Sometimes it was intended as an insult. Often it was used in good humor. But there is truth buried in it. If we are to be secure, confident, and comfortable in who we are, it's important for us to know where we came from. Likewise, knowing where we come from can help us to stay out of trouble, to guide us toward our future goals. As the followers of Jesus Christ, it's helpful for us to understand where we came from, how we got where we are, so that we can better understand where we're going and guide us towards the goals towards which we should aspire. We begin this morning with God's call of the prophet Isaiah. We read that story in Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were the seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." And then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. And with it, he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." And then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." Isaiah knew that he was unqualified to speak for God because of his sin and his imperfection, and because he lived in among a people who were sinful and imperfect. But God came to Isaiah and did for him what he could not do for himself. He God purified Isaiah's lips. God took away Isaiah's guilt and atoned for his sin so that Isaiah could speak for God. And afterwards, Isaiah relents and he says, "Here am I. Send me." But as we've been discussing for the last several weeks, the birth, death, and resurrection of Jesus and the coming of the Spirit of God bring about a transformation in the way that God relates and the way that God communicates with his people and with his church. We hear Jesus explain a part of that transformation to the Pharisee Nicodemus in John chapter 3. In that story, it says, "Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. And he came to Jesus at night. He said, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs that you are doing if God were not with him.' Jesus replied, 'Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again.' 'How can someone be born when they are old?' Nicodemus asked. 'Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born.' Jesus answered, 'Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. And so it is with everyone born of the Spirit.' 'How can this be?' Nicodemus asked. 'You are Israel's teacher,' said Jesus. And do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Jesus said that following God is not enough, but that the followers of God must be born again by being born of the Spirit, by putting their faith and trust in Jesus. This is the extension of what we saw in Isaiah in a moment ago as an individual, an extension to all of God's people collectively. God came to Isaiah, purified him, and atoned for his sin so that he could serve and speak for God. But through his life, death, and resurrection, Jesus atoned for our sins, purified us, so that we can serve God and do his work. And with the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit of God, we are given the strength of God and equipped for service. That's exactly what we've been talking about for the last 2 weeks, so none of that should be particularly surprising. We discover the interesting part when we start to trace our lineage. When we start to find our history and begin to understand how our heritage, how that path through history helps us understand who we are. In Romans chapter 8, Paul begins to connect those dots for us when he says, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, and you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God, and co-heirs with Jesus Christ, if indeed we share in His suffering, in order that we may also share in His glory." Paul says that the coming of the Spirit of God is evidence of our adoption by God as brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ and heirs of God, which incidentally means that God is our daddy. And that adoption completes the lineage that Scripture has been drawing for us since the time of the prophets in the Old Testament, where we first discover God at work. We discover in the Old Testament God at work for and among His people. But then God sends Jesus to bring the removal of guilt and atonement for sin. And after Jesus' ascension into heaven, Jesus in turn sends the Spirit. And the Spirit brings about our adoption as sons and daughters of God. Put another way, Scripture describes for us how God moved us from condemnation and guilt toward our perfection and our eternal home. We moved from guilt to adoption, from adoption to inheritance, and from inheritance to glory. But, Paul says, our adoption also brings us an obligation for the indescribable gift that we have been given. But Paul also notes that this obligation is not an obligation to flesh. It is not an obligation for us to feel good. It's not an obligation for us to involve our lives, to devote our lives to our own creature comforts and our own pleasure. It is not an obligation to principalities or powers or people or priests or pastors, but it is an obligation to live by the Spirit of God, to live the way that God calls upon us to live, to do the work of the kingdom of heaven, to share in the suffering of Jesus so that we might also share in His glory in our eternal home. It's that obligation that brings us full circle from where we started, because as we move from guilt to adoption, from adoption to inheritance, from inheritance to glory, from glory to service, we hear God asking us the same question that He asked Isaiah: "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us. And because our guilt has been atoned for, because our sin has been washed away, because we have been adopted by God as sons and daughters, with God as our daddy, as co-heirs with Jesus Christ, as we have been filled, equipped, and strengthened by the Spirit of God, we hear Paul urging us to answer God's question the way that Isaiah did. Here am I. Send me. I have a number of prayer requests, a couple of new ones. Prayers, please, for Carol Henry. Carol is a friend of Susan Dicer, who has been placed in hospice. She's not expected to be with us more than a couple of weeks. So please pray for Carol Henry and for her friend Susan Dicer. Also, prayers, I received a request this morning from our friend Dee Dee Jackson. The Jacksons we met because they were at the time missionaries to Kenya. They stayed in our home when they were on furlough at one point some years ago. They're full-time in the United States now, but they're still in ministry. Dee Dee has been diagnosed with thyroid cancer and is going to have surgery on June 4th. So if you would include Dee Dee Jackson in your prayers, we would appreciate that as well. Also, prayers for Betty Coleman. She is our visitation member of the week. As always, I encourage you to contact Betty. Let her know you're thinking of her. Send her a card or a note. And also, here's our prayer list. Carol Henry, as I mentioned. George Lee, Victor Lee's father. Prayers for Kathy Morris's sister, Tina. Haven Ackley's great-niece, Andrea Barrett. Cora Riggs, our school teacher from Harrisburg, Liberia. Edie Cart, Kitty Pedersall, Viola Lipp, Craig Sheets, Timothy Walters, Mike Freshwater, Connie Woodson, Bridget McNulty, Heather Henline, Craig George, Terry Walmsley, Drew Schuster, Brandon Hookway, and Amanda Montgomery. Our also sympathy and prayers are extended to Dawn Marshall, to the family and friends of Dawn Marshall. She is a sister of Robin Jones. Dawn Marshall passed away May 18th. Now, as always, if you have any additional prayers or concerns or joys that you would like to share with the congregation, you'd like to have us lift up in our prayers, please feel free to contact church office or post a comment to this video or email the pastor or whatever is most convenient for you. But if you let us know, we will include your prayers with ours. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we give thanks for all the ways that you bless us every day. We confess that we have not been perfect. We have missed the mark. We've failed to be the people you called us to be. We haven't done the things you called upon us to do. We've done things you asked us not to do. For all the things and for all the ways that we've gotten it wrong, we're sorry. We pray for your forgiveness. Purify us again. Wash us. make us better than we were. Cleanse us so that we can be better today than we were yesterday, better tomorrow than we have been today. We lift up to you all these folks that we have shared with one another. We pray for Carol Henry, who has been placed in hospice. We pray that you would encourage her and walk with her and give her strength, but also her family and her friends like Susan. Give them courage and strength and allow them to be an encouragement to Carol. Help them as they walk with her on this final journey. We pray for Dee Dee Jackson, who will be having thyroid cancer on June 4th. We pray that the surgeons would be able to do the thing that they intend to do, that they would get all of the cancer, that the treatments would be successful, and that Dee Dee would be able to make a full recovery. We lift up Betty Coleman, our person of the week. We pray that you would be an encouragement to her and that you would call upon many of our church folk to be encouragers to her. We pray for Carol Henry, George Lee, Tina, Andrea, Cora, Edie, Kitty, Viola, Craig, for Timothy, Mike, Connie, and Bridget, for Heather, Craig, Terry, Drew, and Amanda. We pray you'd pour out mercy and grace and healing and hope, and we pray that you would be at work meeting their needs, that you would come alongside of them and help them to know that we are praying for them, that they are loved, that you are with them. We pray that you know their most intimate needs. We pray you would be at work giving them the courage and the strength and whatever else they need to make it through another day and another day. We pray for the family and friends of Don Marshall, who passed away May 18th. We pray that you would give them courage and strength and hope as they try to make sense of the world without their loved one in it. We pray that you would walk with them as they mourn and grieve and begin to discover a new normal. Help them to hear your voice and walk with you. We give thanks, O Lord, for all your gifts, for your Son Jesus, and for this prayer that he taught to his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we go to our closing hymn, I just want to say, it helps for us to know where we came from. It helps for us to know, to understand who we are by understanding how we got to where we are, from where our ancestors used to be. And this story, these stories that we've read this morning, these are the stories of our history. These are the stories of how we got to where we are from where we were. We are very much in the same place as Isaiah. We know we live in a culture that that is sinful and imperfect. And we know that we are people who are sinful and imperfect. And we cry out to God that how can God possibly use me when I'm so fallible? You know? But God's message to us is the same message he had for Isaiah. He said, I have purified you. I have removed your guilt. I have forgiven your sin. I have filled you with my Spirit and given you everything you need. Knowing that, God asks us, who will go for us? Whom shall I send? I hope that you will answer the way that Isaiah did, that you will join me in answering, here I am. Send me. Have a great week, everybody.
Spread a will provide till their hearts receive. satisfied.